Torrey Snow, Dan Joseph, WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
All right, so earlier today, Governor Moore gave his State of the State address, and I mean, admittedly, he hit the ground running, right? He was just inaugurated, what was it, last week?
2 weeks ago.
It was 2 weeks ago, and has to put together a budget and announces his agenda. He gave about a 45-minute speech. Laying out his platform, and one of the interesting things was that he specifically said, well, you know, just because you lose an election doesn't mean you should not be included with governing for the next 4 years, which sounded to me like a commitment to involve Republicans in discussions in Annapolis. So joining us to give us a little bit of insight on that is Senator Justin Reedy. He's a good friend of mine and he frequents the show. And Senator Reedy, thanks so much for joining us. I know you guys are in the thick of things. And can we just get your initial reaction to Governor Moore's State of the State speech today and what some of your observations were?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me on. And, you know, it's an important tradition to give a State of the State address. And any governor will use it to sort of lay out their thoughts and agenda for the upcoming year, and certainly the first time a governor, you know, comes in that are laying out vision for how they view their administration. And, you know, the governor's a great speaker. He's very energetic, has a good sense of humor. So there are things that he makes a compelling presentation when he speaks. You know, there were things that he talked about that obviously I agree with and think can be good, including the call to service. You know, I think all of us could stand to it's great to be able to serve, to have people who want to serve in their communities. I don't know that we necessarily need a state level agency to conduct that. That's sort of a common theme of what.
Well, what does that look like, Senator? He talked about service the entire speech. When you put that into play, what do you think that is? Because it's very broadly defined, as Wes Moore put it.
Yeah, I think the question you just asked sort of illustrates perhaps maybe the issue with the speech. And of course, any State of the State address is going to be a little bit general, but a lot of generalities in the speech, not a ton of specifics. Even some of the bills that he mentioned that he's proposing, he only gave sort of a broad swath to them. They've only just started putting them out, so we're going to have to get into the details. The idea of ending child poverty and talking about how we can choose to do it, well, who among us wants children to be poor? Of course, we agree. And some of the things he's mentioning about doing make some sense. I'm not sure that expanding the minimum wage and adding it to the CPI and making it automatically go up every year is necessarily the way to do it. But there are some other things he proposed that could be good. He talked about cutting taxes, retirement taxes for veterans, which none of us disagree with that. Why don't we just go ahead and do it for everybody? Because the actual cost, quote unquote, cost is not that great. And the very arguments he used for why we should reduce taxes for retired veterans is exactly what we should just do for all retirees, but of course agree with doing it for veterans. So, you know, there was good and bad there. I think one real missed opportunity that I saw in the speech was a real lack of any sort of specific mention of violent crime, really dealing with the issue of violent crime. Now, he has a couple of occasions recently, I understand he's been asked questions about, you know, doing something on repeat violent offenders and, you know, illegal guns and things like that. And he's expressed some support for that. But it would have been nice for him to say, hey, in addition to the economy, which I was glad he spent some time talking about how we want to improve the economy. He did not talk about the other issue that's really weighing on Marylanders' minds, which is their safety.
Yeah, it
seems like that's a bit of a sacred cow to just come out and say, as a Democrat governor, you know, just to come out and say, hey, I don't know why it is, but it seems like it's a little bit of a trepidation. Just come out and say, hey, yeah, we need to lock up these repeat violent offenders and make sure they're not out on the streets.
Well, that's why he probably didn't mention it, because he has trouble saying because a lot of his constituency doesn't want to hear it.
I just want to remind our listeners, we're speaking with Senator Justin Reedy. And, let's talk a bit about that. There's a little bit of confusion. I know that State's Attorney Ivan Bates has testified before members of the General Assembly about some specific legislation, right? Everyone's calling it the Bates Bill. We know that it has been filed in the House. I'm hearing different rumors about what's the Senate side, but can you catch our listeners up? If this is going to become law this year, what has to happen on the Senate side? Is there a Senate sponsor yet, and is there any discussion, and what are the odds that this legislation gets passed this session?
Well, the Bates Bill, as I understand it, is different than the Repeat Violent Offenders Bill. It deals with people who are illegally carrying prohibited persons that are illegally, obviously illegally right. carrying a gun and having some much tougher penalties. I think we all support that. Our Senate Republican caucus is actually working. Senator Folden was on, I think, yesterday with you all, with Gary Collins, about talking about the Repeat Violent Offenders Act that we have gotten passed through the Senate twice in the last couple years in a bipartisan way and just would kind of not get a vote in the House and disappear. So both of those issues, I think, you don't have to have a Senate crossfile for a bill to pass. It can pass the House and come to the Senate. I assume there will be a Senate crossfile appearing shortly on that Ivan Bates bill. I don't have it in front of me, obviously, who it is. But they're both important issues. Really,
got it.
Because this is what bothers me about, and I thought it was a missed opportunity when he's talking about how we don't have to make false choices. You know, Governor Moore likes to talk about how we can choose to do both things at once on different issues. And in a lot of cases, he's actually right, of course. A lot of times we set up false choices in government. We shouldn't. So I think that talking point in general is not a bad point to make about specific issues. But on the crime issue, they always talk about how, well, yeah, we want to go after violent offenders, repeat violent offenders, but we want to be balanced. And I've heard him say this. I've heard a lot of other folks say it, and some of my colleagues too. And it's like, okay, guys, this is the balance. We don't have any balance right now. It's all like, well, we need more resources. Let's dump more resources in. Let's give more second chances. And we're not talking – when we talk about repeat violent offenders not getting serious jail time, we're not talking about a 14-year-old that stole a car, okay? We're talking about people who've purposely – they're the ones causing a lot of the crime in Baltimore City and in other places around the area is people who have repeatedly been arrested for things. In many cases, they've been repeatedly violent and done criminal acts with firearms, and yet they're still out walking the streets. I think we can agree that to get balance, we need to make sure that those most dangerous people who have chosen repeatedly to break the law and hurt someone else on purpose should spend significant time in jail. So to me, that was the missed opportunity today, was that that's a huge issue we need to address.
Senator, I have trouble pinning down Wes Moore, ideologically speaking. Where do you think he really stands? Is he a progressive? Is he ideologically even further to the left of that? Or do you see him more as a traditional liberal? Is he a radical, or is he just sort of a regular Democrat?
You know, I think he is a progressive. I think he would say he's a progressive. I think he's pretty liberal on a lot of issues. I think there are some issues where it sounds like he's more open to the idea of, you know, of being a little more pro-business on some things. But it's sort of right now, a lot of the rhetoric sort of comes from this place of we can use businesses to help achieve progressive ideals, but the government's going to force you to do it. And I'm more from the perspective of if we have a policy of wanting to lift up working families, for example, and how to help children get out of poverty and people get out of poverty, finding ways to incentivize and work in a market system and not just – can the government just write a check? And by the government, that's us, by the way, taxpayers. Can we write a check and get everybody out of poverty? Well, I mean, theoretically, I guess you could, but then there would be other trade-offs that would happen. It's sort of like – so I don't really know how to answer that question right now. Governor has been – I've spoken with him a couple times. He's been very friendly. He has extended a hand, says he wants to work with Republicans. He said that in the speech. And we take him at his word, and we want to try to, you know, collaborate on issues where we can agree. But right now, you know, I think it's kind of the new Democratic Party ideology seems to be one of – you talk a lot about equity and talk a lot about those kind of issues – some of which is fair points, but it seems like it's hard to pin down. You're right to the fact that I couldn't answer your question very clearly says it's hard to pin down. I think he probably likes being hard to pin down. You know, so some of the rhetoric you hear from him and his administration sounds very like, you know, one way, and then other times it depends. Sometimes it can go a little harder the other way. But, you know, we're certainly, as Republicans, we're going to try to work together as best we can. You know, his budget that came out did not break the bank at first. Now they may add money to it, but at least the budget that came out was at least, you know, not didn't soar in spending. So that was a good thing. So I mean, it's not all negative. But I did really think on some hard issues, which apparently cracking down on violent crime is a hard issue for some folks in Annapolis. I'm not sure why. That they kind of ducked on that one.
Before we let you go, what is the best chance that the Democrats and Republicans with Wes Moore support have on working together? What issue do you think is the most likely to get both your enthusiastic support and the Democrats' enthusiastic support?
Enthusiastic support. That's interesting. I think helping veterans. We all know we want to support our veterans, and not just a talking point. I mean, there are real issues the veteran community deals with. And if we can, and I did think he did a good job. Governor Moore made a very, I thought, Republican argument about why you want to cut taxes and keep people in Maryland, because you can't just look at the bottom line of how much tax you quote cut. You look at all the benefits of keeping somebody here. I think that logic should be extended to a lot of our tax policy, quite frankly. But there's an area where I think hopefully there'd be enthusiasm. And I hope on the issue of public safety and crime, the average rank and file registered Democrat in this state is 100% enthusiastic, I think, about putting away repeat violent offenders. So I would hope we could work on that together. And I think hopefully there's some opportunity. And one last issue, I will say to governors on the issue of broadband in our rural and underserved areas, they do seem to be really interested in doing more on that. And there's even some tax-related issues that they're working on. So look, it wasn't all bad. It's not all bad. I hope we can find some areas to work together on for sure.
Senator Reedy, as always, thanks so much for joining the program. Thanks for the work that you and your colleagues are doing in the General Assembly, and good luck in that swamp pit.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Take care. That was Senator Justin Reedy, and offered out a pretty decent layout of what they're facing before them. I thought that the broadband issue was actually really, really interesting.
It's good to hear the other side, and it's good to hear the Republicans' perspective on all this. I know it sometimes seems like they're just going to be observers. They're not going to really be doing anything, but it's good to see that they're going to take a proactive role.